Good morning, everyone. It's Pastor Jim Harkabus from New Canyon Community Church. It's September the 18th, 2022. We're glad you're with us. This morning, we'll be continuing our series on 1 Corinthians, Correcting Spiritual Immaturity in the Local Church. We'll be looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 9, and Paul is giving an example of the Christian and personal liberty in regard to the gray areas of life, things not spelled out specifically in Scripture. Glad you're with us. Let's have a song. We'll join our message in progress.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's a word that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. Sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you, all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single say. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. Oh no, you search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you.
Please open your Bibles with me here in the New Testament to 1 Corinthians. We'll be in 1 Corinthians. There's a Bible underneath your bookshelf if you don't have one, or if you have a phone device, that's fine too. And we're going to be coming to chapter 9 of 1 Corinthians. And as we do, we're in the middle of the book. And for those who maybe joined us partway through the series, I go through a book of the Bible from start to finish, verse by verse, chapter by chapter, and right in the middle of 1 Corinthians chapter 9. And to understand the context of the book, the theme of 1 Corinthians is correcting spiritual immaturity in the local church. And an amazing thing happened in a town called Corinth in Greece. Corinth was just a mess of a town, very steeped in Greek philosophy, had many deities they worshipped. It was a very highly sexually charged city with all types of sexual immorality. It even had the temple to Aphrodite on the south end of the town and on the Aqua Corinth with 1,000 priestesses, priests and priestesses, 1,000 prostitutes, male and female, came down to town to ply the trade. It was a seaport town. It was just a real mess. And out of this moral mess, of people's destroyed lives, the gospel came to town, brought by this little guy named Paul of Tarsus. And Paul came, preached the gospel, and people got changed. They believed in Jesus Christ, that he died for their sins and rose again the third day. And they were born again. They became new people. They were new people on the inside. And they were turning from their former way of living, but they were still, it was a growing process. And the church was like 4 years old when this letter was written. And so some were proceeding really well. Some were just kind of stunted. Some were still struggling as they were spiritually babies, spiritually born toddlers, basically. And so they still adapting some of the world's culture and world's thinking in their mind. And so the church was a hot mess. And so Paul's writing to correct spiritual maturity and dealing with church problems. He dealt with the problem of divisions and schisms within the church. He dealt with moral sexual sin within the church. He said, you need to deal with this. And then in the last half, he's dealing with questions that these young believers asked of him. And chapter 7 dealt with the issue of personal relationships, and Paul's dealing with the issue and answering your questions concerning being single, being married, getting divorced, getting remarried, all that. And chapter 7 dealt with that. Chapter 8, 9, 10, and the first verse of chapter 11, Paul's dealing with the area of those, what they call the gray areas of life, with a Christian's personal liberty. We'll talk about that in just a minute. But the gray areas, the Bible spells out certain things we can do and not to do. Not to steal, not to lie, not to get drunk, not to engage in sexual sin. But there are other areas of life that the Bible doesn't talk about. It doesn't talk about smoking cigarettes. It doesn't talk about going to movie theaters. It doesn't talk about wearing what you should wear to church. And so those issues that the Bible doesn't spell out, we call the gray areas of life. And Paul's going to set forth three principles we've seen so far from chapter 8, right in the middle of a big section here, of how do you handle those things that are not spelled out in Scripture that you can or cannot do. And he gives three principles. So first off, this activity I'm partaking in, whether it's having a cigarette or a stogie after church, or having a glass of wine with my dinner, or what should I wear to church, and whatever activity is, watch a movie, go to movie theater, play cards, all the things, and sometimes people get hung up on. Is this activity helpful to me? Is it going to help me or hinder me in my spiritual life? If obviously this activity is not going to help me, it's going to pull me down by watching R-rated movies or whatever, then maybe I shouldn't watch R-rated movies. The second thing is this I'm partaking in this activity, is it going to control me and master me, and I will be addicted to it later on? If it is, then I shouldn't partake of that activity. But then this third activity, is this thing going to be helpful or edify others? Is it going to build others up, or will it tear them down or harm them in their spiritual growth by me doing that? And so Paul's addressing that. And as you come to chapter 9, a long way of getting around to circling the barn twice and get into the barn, he's going to talk about, use an example of his own life, of limiting his own freedom he had as to not to hurt others, and not to damage the gospel message. And that's the point of chapter 9. See, freedom involves love. We are free. But it all involves responsibility toward others. Galatians 5:13 says, "For you are called to freedom, brethren. Do not turn your freedom into an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another." I'm reading 1 Corinthians chapter 9. We're going to cover the first 18 verses this morning. It's more verses. We won't get there. I'll be hard put to get through that in 30 minutes, but we'll give it a go. Chapter 9, beginning verse 1 of 1 Corinthians chapter 9. You want to follow along in your Bibles or on your devices. Paul says, "Am I not free? Am I not an apostle? Have I not seen Jesus our Lord? Are you not my work in the Lord? If to others I'm not an apostle, at least I am to you, for you are the seal of my apostleship in the Lord. My defense to those who examine me is this. Do we not have a right to drink? Do we not have a right to take along a believing wife, even as the rest of the apostles and the brothers of the Lord and Cephas? Or do only Barnabas and I not have a right to refrain from working? Who at any time serves as a soldier at his own expense? Who plants a vineyard and does not eat of it? Who does not tend the flock and does not use the milk of the flocks? I'm not speaking these things according to human judgment, am I? Or what does the law say about these things? For it is written in the law of Moses, you shall not muzzle the ox while he is threshing. God is not concerned about oxen, is he? Or is he speaking together for our sake? Yes, for our sake it is written, because the plowman ought to plow in hope, and the thresher to thresh in hope, and sharing the crop. If we sowed spiritual things in you, is it too much that we reap material things from you? If others share the right over you, do we not more? Nevertheless, we do not use this right, but we endure all things that we have not caused no hindrance to the gospel of Christ. Verse 11. Do you not know that those who perform sacred service eat the food of the temple, and those who attend regularly to the altar have their share from the altar? So also the Lord directed those who proclaim the gospel to get their living from the gospel. But I have used none of these things, and I'm not writing these things so that it would be done in my case. It would be better for me to die than to have any man make my boast an empty one. For if I preach the gospel, I have nothing to boast of, but I am under compulsion. For woe is me if I do not preach the gospel. For if I do this voluntarily, I have a reward. But if against my will, I have a stewardship entrusted to me. What then is my reward? That when I preach the gospel, I may offer the gospel without charge, so as not to make full use of my right in gospel. Now, Paul is kind of being kind of wordy here, but we're going to dive into this and sort this out a little bit. Again, Paul's going to use his life an example of self-imposed limitations on a freedom he has in order not to hurt others, believers, and not to damage the gospel message. And he's used that of support, of receiving financial support from the local church at Corinth. 1 Corinthians 9, we read that. Verse 1 says, am I not free? Am I not an apostle? Have I not seen Jesus our Lord? Are you not my work in the Lord? Now, this is a rhetorical question often used by Greek philosophers in Corinth. They're used to that. And those questions asked with either a yes or no to the posed questions. And the answer to these questions are yes. Am I not free? Paul, yes, you are free. In fact, we read in 1 Corinthians 6:12, it says, all things are lawful for me, but not all things are profitable. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be mastered by anything. We saw that in 1 Corinthians 6:12. Am I not an apostle? Well, yes, Paul, you're an apostle. You told us you're called by an apostle. In fact, we know you're an apostle because of your calling by Jesus Christ. Have I not seen Jesus our Lord? And the answer to that question is yes. Rhetorical question. The Lord Jesus Christ personally appeared to Paul on the road to Damascus. The story is found in Acts chapter 9. I'm going to take time to look at there. The Lord met Paul on the road to Damascus. Paul was on the way to persecute and put believers in jail. He was an enemy of the gospel. He encountered Jesus Christ. He was a changed person from the inside out. From that moment, he encountered the risen Lord. And not only did the Lord save him, but the Lord called him and he commissioned him as an apostle to the Gentiles. He's going to stand before kings and before the Gentiles, and it's going to be an amazing story of Paul's life. Concerning apostles, we need to talk about that. The word apostle there is apostolos in the Greek. It's a delegate or a messenger, one sent forth with orders or commissioned. Now, in the strictest sense, an apostle, because there's confusion in the day in church today, people claim to be apostles. In the strictest sense, an apostle is one limited to the 12 who laid the foundation of the church. They were personally called by Jesus Christ, somewhere at the Sea of Galilee, when he called the fishermen. He called Matthew at the tax booth. He's going to call Apostle Paul on the road to Damascus. And each of these 12 had seen the risen Christ after his resurrection. There originally were 12. Remember that the gospel story that Judas Iscariot betrayed Jesus and he took his own life. And so Paul is the replacement for Judas Iscariot, I believe. Each of these apostles received their commission directly from the Lord. Paul did, again, as I mentioned, on the road to Damascus in Acts chapter 9. Each of the apostles saw Jesus Christ after his resurrection from the dead. He appeared to them in the upper room and to Paul again on the road. These apostles exercised a special revelation. They received revelation. They spoke, and the scriptures were inspired by them as the Holy Spirit came upon them in the early days. they were given an express commission to found and start churches. That's what they did. And Paul met each of those criteria. I don't believe anyone can claim the office of apostle today in the strictest sense because they do not meet the qualifications. There are those who claim to be apostles with the New Apostolic Reformation, but for above reasons, they don't qualify. But we have to remember, folks, that the Bible warns against false apostles too. And let's look to Revelation 2:2 for a moment, because we live in a day of people claiming that behind the whole New Apostolic Reformation movement going on in church today, part of the apostasy taking place is foretold in the end times. The church at Ephesus, Jesus wrote to the angel of the church at Ephesus, he said in Ephesians 2:2, he says, I know your deeds and your toil and perseverance of those you cannot tolerate evil men, and you put to the test those who call themselves apostles, and they are not, and you have found them to be false. So there is a reality of false apostles out there who say they're apostle, they're not. An apostle is one who visited the Lord Jesus, they seen the Lord Jesus Christ alive from the dead. In a practical, though, in a generic sense, everyone who is sent out by Jesus Christ is an apostle. You're, in a sense, an apostle in a generic sense. You're the Great Commission is to make disciples of all men. That applies to you and to me. And especially those who go out from a single place to another place to minister, in a true sense, they're an apostle. We call them missionaries today, but truly they're apostles. They were commissioned by God. They were called apart, set apart to go out somewhere. Ted Rivers, in a sense, was an apostle. He was a part of Canyon Community Church. God called him, went to Bible college. He was commissioned, went with Village Missions, served as a Village Missionary, retired Village Missionary. He was an apostle. He was a missionary. And others have done the same. But as far as the strict sense of that title or office of an apostle, that remains with the 12, the original 12. On verse 2, going back to the 1 Corinthians 9. Says, if others I'm not an apostle, at least I am to you, for you are the seal of my apostleship in the Lord. That word seal is very interesting. And back in the day, in the times of the New Testament, they had, if you're going to seal a document, say a transcript or official document, official orders or something like that, you had a stamp and you had a wax seal and you pressed the stamp into the seal and sealed it closed. Now we lick the envelopes and close them. Back then they put a piece of wax, they didn't have adhesive, put a piece of wax, melted wax, and a stamp and said, this is from whoever. And some people do that fancy cards that they have for, you know, wedding invites and something like that. Basically it's an embossment. Embossment, you do a fancy stamp on a piece of paper. You see that sometimes with birth certificates. You see it with marriage licenses. You see it in other title deeds, other things, official documents. Paul's saying that to you, you are the proof. You are the genuine seal of my apostleship in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what he's trying to say. You're the authentication of my apostleship, the result of Paul's ministry. He come to Corinth. What a mess he preached. It was very tumultuous time, but people were saved and their lives were turned over and they were new people in Jesus Christ and growing in him. Verse 3, he says, my defense of those who examine is this. And we find from this verse here and also the whole gist of 2 Corinthians, the 2 Corinthians letter, that there were some who didn't accept Paul as an apostle. We saw from chapter 1 of 1 Corinthians that there are those who were followers of Cephas or of Simon Peter. Remember, divisions taking place. Some followed Apollos, some followed Peter. And the Peter people called Peter. Well, Peter was a real apostle. He was with Jesus from the beginning, but this Paul guy, some Johnny come lately. So they rejected his apostleship. So Paul's kind of on the defensive about that, and he's addressing those people. He says, in my defense to those examining me is this. Do we not have a right to eat and drink? Oh, rhetorical question. Of course they do. Do we not have a right to take along a believing wife? It is the rest of the apostles and the brothers of the Lord in Cephas. And the answer, of course, is yes. Rhetorical question. Now, it's interesting. We get a little glimpse of New Testament history here from this verse. That the verse offers insights in the first century apostles. Remember them? Peter, James, John, Andrew, Thomas, and the rest. Apparently, some of them had wives, and some of the wives traveled with them after the gospel, you know, Jesus rose from the dead and ascended to heaven. They traveled with their husbands as they traveled about starting churches and sharing the gospel. depending on the safety of the issue and family responsibilities. We know that Peter was married because in the Gospels, Jesus healed Peter's mother-in-law in Luke chapter 4, verse 38-41. And then the brothers of the Lord. Now remember, Jesus had half-brothers and sisters. You want to look at Mark chapter 6 for a moment? Mark chapter 6, verses 2 to 3. We'll read that passage. And while you're looking there, the brothers of the Lord mentioned here is one is Jude, who is going to be the writer of the book of Jude in the New Testament. And the other is going to be James, who is going to be the leader of the Jerusalem church. His story is found in Acts chapter 15, where he pops in there. It's not James, the son of Zebedee, the brother of John. Remember, James, the son of Zebedee, was killed in Acts chapter 12 by Herod. Acts chapter 15, another James is the leader of the church, the head elder of the church of Jerusalem. It's that. And they were half-brothers of Jesus. Let's listen. I'm reading Mark chapter 6, verse 2 to 3. And when the Sabbath came, he, meaning Jesus, began to teach in a synagogue. And the many listeners were astonished, saying, well, where did this man get these things? And what is this wisdom given to him? And with such miracles are these performed by his hands? Is this not the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and Judas or Jude and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. So apparently, Jesus had half-brothers on Mary's side. Remember, Jesus was a virgin born, but Joseph was the father of Jude and James and his sisters and the other ones there. And anyhow, these apostles and the brothers of the Lord who served, they came to know Jesus, believed in Jesus after he rose from the dead. Their wives traveled to safety, family responsibility is involved. You know, many younger missionary families and pastors' families, oftentimes the pastor's wife who should be have a limited ministerial involvement just because of she has to balance ministry with family responsibilities, child rearing, getting the kids up, getting them to school, home teaching, so on and so forth. And as their children leave the nest, they grow up and leave the nest, hopefully they leave the nest, the pastor's wife or a missionary wife would take a more active role in ministry, traveling with her husband, etc. I think of Billy Graham and Ruth Graham. When the Graham kids were young, she stayed at home. Billy Graham was the evangelist, traveling around, going to crusades all over, and Ruth stayed at home, and she traveled more with him as the kids were obviously older and grown up and left the nest. Verse 6, 1 Corinthians 9, verse 6. Or do only Barnabas and I not have a right to refrain from working? And of course, the answer is another yes. They have a right. Now, Paul's speaking about being financially supported by the local church. And when we cover it in this section, he's going to cover that a little bit. It's the principle of supporting of gospel workers and pastors and priests runs throughout the Old and New Testaments. We're going to see this. And sometimes the question is, well, why does the church support missionaries? Why does the church support pastors? And this Bible passage helps answer that question. And we're going to see that there's six reasons that why the gospel workers are supported by the local church. Verse 7, 1 Corinthians 9, verse 7. Who at any time serves as a soldier is at his own expense? Who plants a vineyard and does not eat of the fruit of it? Or who tends a flock and does not use the milk of the flock? So we see three examples right here in verse 7 from everyday life. A soldier. What soldier serving in an army, you name the army, has to provide his own weapon, his own ammo, his own food, and that? They're not. The Roman soldiers, they were equipped with the arms, they had food, their lodging, salary to live off of. And same with our soldiers, our fine, brave military men and women today. They don't have to buy their own jet planes. Not buy their own fighter jets, they're pretty expensive, like $60 million or whatever. They have to buy their own ship at $300 million. They're provided. They're provided a gun, they're provided ammo, they're provided the training, they're providing food, MREs, if nothing else. If they're providing a tent or lodging and provided living expenses as a salary. The second example is of a vineyard owner. A vineyard owner, they own and tend a vineyard, grapes, they sell grapes and wine for business, but they also expect to enjoy some of the fruits, no pun intended, of their labors. They have grapes on their table for dinner, or for snacks, or they have a glass of wine as they grow wine to sell. Or who tends a flock or animals, whether it be goats or pigs, sheep or cows? milk and food for their family. Ranchers avail themselves of the meat and milk provided from their livestock. Whether it's a dairy farmer, they're not going to go, they're milking dairy cows, they're not going down to the store to buy milk. That's a no-brainer, is it not? If you're a rancher and you're selling beef to the market, you're not going to sell all the beef to go out on the market to buy it. You're going to, you know, slaughter one of your animals and you live off of that. That's just common sense. That's what Paul's saying as an example of one who tends a flock. Three obvious answers is no, they don't. They benefit from the result of their labor in their work. Verse 8 and 9, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8 and 9. Says, I'm not speaking these things according to human judgment, am I? But what does not the law say of these things? What is written in the law of Moses, you shall not muzzle the ox while he's threshing. God is not concerned about oxen, is he? Now I understand, Paul's addressing, back up for a little bit, Paul's addressing those who didn't accept Paul as an apostle. The church of Corinth was supporting some gospel workers, but they didn't want to support Paul, and Paul says, I'm an apostle. I started the church. I have a right to expect it. And he's given some reasons why that. And he's going to go from the scriptures, from the Old Testament, and do a quote from Deuteronomy chapter 25, verse 4. And understand about the muzzle of the ox while he's threshing. You're going to get some flour. Where do you go to get your flour? Winco, Food Max, right? Or Raley's or whatever. Where did flour come from? It comes from wheat. How did it get turned into flour? It's ground. And they didn't have big fancy mills. What they had in those days, you had a threshing floor, you had a mill, and a grindstone that ground the kernels of the wheat into flour. And those stones are heavy, and so you can either push it yourself, or ta-da, use a donkey or an ox. And they had a donkey hooked up, or an ox would hook up to the threshing with a big wood post with a harness, and he pushed or pulled this thing around in a circle as it grounds the flour. And while obviously it's grinding flour and grinding wheat is kind of messy, and stuff would fall on the ground. And so an ox, what does ox eat? Has In-N-Out burgers, right? No, they don't. I'm just saying if you're still with me. So they eat wheat. It says you don't muzzle the ox. The ox needs energy, so the ox was permitted. The Bible said in the Old Testament, as the ox was working, it was allowed to graze off the fallen wheat on the floor, the threshing floor, to feed itself, to keep its energy to go, and it's not to be muzzled. Not only to be cruel, it was just not practical, not wise. The ox would run out of energy. It's like having a dog and you have to put a dog biscuit in front of a dog. That's cruel, and not let it eat. Threshing, example from Scripture. Verse 10, 1 Corinthians 9:10. Or is he speaking altogether for our sake? Yes, for our sake it was written, because the plowman ought to plow in hope, and the threshers a thresh in hope of sharing the crops. He has two more examples. A person goes and plows a field, prepare it. A farmer's going to prepare it for sowing. Why does he need to go through all that hassle? Well, to make a living. Well, he plows a field to plant a crop, and he'll sell some of the crop for proceeds, but he'll also live off some of the proceeds, whether it's tomatoes or whatever. You guys have a garden. You grow tomatoes or zucchini squash. Do you give it all away, or do you keep some for yourself? Keep some for yourself, right? Same principle. Same with a person that's threshing. They hope they get some benefit of it. What Paul's saying, that he, along with the other workers for the gospel, had the right to expect some financial support for the spiritual blessing and labor they provided. Verse 11, he says, if we sowed spiritual things in you, is it not too much that we reap material things from you? If others share the right over you, do we not more? Nonetheless, we did not use this right. Well, we endure all things and we'd be caused no hindrance for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, again, the church was supporting other gospel workers, and that's awesome. It should. Paul's saying we had the right to expect to reimburse us, to remunerate us financially, but we didn't. We chose not to. We limited our freedom and our right for a purpose. And we'll discuss that as we get a little further into it. You know, missions, mission outreaches, village missions, used to be New Tribes Mission, now it's Ethnoth 360, other mission organizations, what they do, missionaries are going to go out to these fields, whether it's down into the tribes of Papua New Guinea or Africa or wherever they go, They were supported from outside the local field with their ministering. And they're subsidized from outside so they're not to be a burden, and not, people don't think that they're buying the gospel message. The gospel's free. And many missionaries would do that. So they raise the missionary support before they go to the mission field. They go, they're fully supported. They're not required to, you know, expect remuneration from the people they're trying to witness to. But as a church is established and people are saved and their lives are transformed and they're growing spiritually, there is a understanding that they should be, as they give to the Lord, help remunerate the gospel worker. That's what the principle that we see here in chapter 9 of 1 Corinthians. For example, I'll use Village Missions as an example. Village Missions serves rural North America. A local church is having a hard time finding a missionary pastor. They'll contact Village Missions, say, can you send us a missionary pastor? And they'll meet with the church to talk about that. And what they will do, the mission will, if it works out, the mission will send the missionary pastor fully funded without a burden to the church. If it's a brand new start, they don't have a building, they don't have anything. Village Missions will fully fund that missionary on the field as it starts out. Then as people are saved and people are growing and church grows to the point where they can take on some of the support, they're encouraged to do so. And as they do, eventually they arrive at a state of being self-supporting. This church did that a long time ago. Village Missions has been with this church since 1970. 52 years? Oh my goodness. Has it been that long? This church has been self-supporting for a long time, but when it first came in, the church was struggling, and Village Missions subsidized this church until that point where it's... And by the way, if you look at our document, the Village Missions, we send 10% of the church's income to Village Missions. That 10% is used toward helping Village Missions help other unsupported church to help so they can have a missionary there so they can grow and the church will grow and be, eventually hopefully become self-supporting itself. And so it continues and the mission grows and the kingdom of God grows in that regard. Again, Paul's point is that the church of Corinth was supporting other gospel workers. It was Paul who brought the gospel, but he did not want them to support him for a couple reasons. Do you not know that those, he gives reason number five, he said, do you not know, verse 13, that those who perform sacred service eat the food of the temple, and those who attend regularly at the altar have their share from the altar? Paul draws from the Jewish temple in Jerusalem. In Old Testament law, in Leviticus, and in Numbers, and Deuteronomy, provided for the temple priests serving the Lord there in the temple to be materially blessed with a portion of the offerings presented to God by the people. So the offering was brought to the Lord. The priests were allowed, authorized by the law, and they're instructed to take a portion of that, but they lived off of part of the proceeds. Finally, reason number six. Verse 14, 1 Corinthians 9, 14. So also the Lord directed those who proclaimed the gospel to get their living from the gospel. And his final example, Jesus, when he sent out the 12 and the 70 in the gospels on short-term missionary assignments, they're to take nothing but to rely on the people they went to for food, lodging, and clothing. And just they were sent out, and when I sent out, ask for money to just go. And whatever the people were blessed as you shared the gospel, they showed hospitality to you and blessing you. Great. Back to 1 Corinthians 9, verse 15. I know this is I sense you're having a hard time following me. Am I right? Hang in there. Verse 15. I've used none of these things. And I'm not writing these things that would be done in my case, for it would be better for me to be died than for any man to make him a boast an empty one. Paul saying, while he could expect his support, he chose not to. He did not want them to think that he was a mooch. He did not want them distracted to think that they're buying salvation by giving money, like some people who are selling a product. Worship God and give me money and you'll be blessed. That's nonsense. He didn't want that, the gospel confused with money. Excuse me, verse 16. It says, if I preach the gospel, I have nothing to boast of, for I'm under compulsion, for woe is me if I preach not the gospel. Paul saying his motivation for doing this, to proclaim the gospel, is not from any benefit he might receive. He's not doing it for financial gain, but from the commission he received from God. And he said, woe is me if I do not preach the gospel. See, Paul's talking about something here that is important for every gospel work. If you feel like the Lord's leading you to do something for the Lord, he's calling you to do something. There is a compulsion, there's a command, and there's a drive within you. My friends, when people go into ministry, vocational ministry as a missionary, a pastor, a teacher, whatever, there's a unique calling that God has set them apart, just as he set apart Paul and Barnabas for them to be go out from the in Acts chapter 12 and 13 to go forth on the missionary journeys. God has to set that person apart. If they're not called for that ministry, it's going to be a disaster. Some people say, well, it's so cool to be a pastor. Oh, yeah, you got to be, you know, instant fame. And look at some of these pastors, these fellow, the fancy stuff. All of the wrong reasons. Paul says, I'm doing it because God commissioned me on the road to Damascus. I don't have a choice in the matter. I'm under compulsion. I'm under obligation. I have a drive. And probably one example of that is that of the story of Old Testament prophet Jeremiah. Sad story about Jeremiah. He ministered for over 30 years. Not one convert or not one person listened to him after 30 years of preaching faithfully. Amazing. He was beaten. He was thrown down into a well. And finally, he said, I give up. I quit. But he did. But then he found out he couldn't stop. It was like a dryness in his bones. He just had to share God's message. And it's that call to ministry that keeps a person going. Someone has said, if you can do anything else in life and be content, then God's not called you into vocational ministry. But if nothing else is satisfied, you can't do anything. If nothing else seems to meet that need in your life, then God is possibly calling you to ministry. How true that is. I heard that as a young man when I asked my pastor about that before I was going into ministry. Verse 17 and 18, wrap this up. We're going to stop here at verse 18. So if I do this voluntarily, I always have a reward, but against my will, I have a stewardship entrusted to me. What then is my reward? That when I preach the gospel, I may offer the gospel without charge, so not make full right of my use of the gospel. Paul chose to limit his freedom, getting back to his long example of these 18 verses, and his right to be supported by the Corinthian believers, one to not to be beholden to them, a very pride-filled, very carnal-filled church, and he didn't want to be beholden to them, nor did he want to confuse the gospel message with financial and material remuneration. And we're going to stop here for now for time. The last part of the chapter is a great part. I wouldn't have time to develop now because it's already noon. We're going to talk about a crown that the believers can win. See, the Bible talks about a prize that the Lord Jesus wants to give us when we get to heaven. In fact, there's a crown. It's called a Stephanos, or a crown. And there are five crowns mentioned in the New Testament that believers can get. And one of these we can see in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, the crown incorruptible, which is living a disciplined life for the Lord, running a consistent race of life for Jesus Christ. And we'll see that next time when we get there. In the meantime, let's pray. Father, I thank you for this portion of your word. Some of this may not seem applicable to some of us. For some, it's good to know. Father, you conclude this portion of your word for our understanding. And while I was dealing with a local issue in Corinth, it gives insights of why the church does what it does even 2,000 years later. Of the preparation of people for ministry and supporting gospel workers. We thank you, Lord, for those men and women who've gone, left their homes, left their jobs to go bring the gospel of Jesus Christ to other parts of the world. They left their home, they got the training, and they stepped out in faith. Father, we just thank you for this passage of scripture. May you bring application to it as we continue on. And Lord, as we finish up this chapter next time, looking at chapter 9, we're talking about the race of the life, race of the Christian life, and the rewards that await those at the end of the race. We ask your blessing on our time. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us stand and we'll close with a song.
Christ to know.